You know, my favorite thing about complex numbers is they let you take things where they're not originally meant to go and get meaningful results. That's exactly how they were found in the first place, allowing negatives under square roots. In the case of Fibonacci numbers and similar sequences, they provide a way to look between discrete steps of addition, and then it goes much, much further. So we need to do this in two parts. Today, we'll be getting cozy with Fibonacci numbers and related sequences in the complex plane, and start with some gentle generalization to pave the way for an even richer world ahead. If you're so inclined, you might enjoy watching this with paper and pencil on hand, but it's not necessary. It also works to just sit back and enjoy the results, and there are resources in the description you can use later to play around with what I'm going to be showing you. Let's go! Fibonacci and Lucas numbers both follow a simple recurrence relation, defining each subsequent number as a sum of the two previous ones. What makes them different is just the numbers we choose to start this relation with. We can also run these sequences backwards by just inverting their definitions. So for Fibonacci numbers, before 0 we'd get 1 minus 0, that's another 1, then before that 0 minus 1, a minus 1, and if we keep doing that, we'll observe that it's the Fibonacci numbers again, only this time they appear with alternating signs. The same sort of thing happens when we extend Lucas numbers backwards. We get the same numbers mirrored with alternating signs. They both go on like that forever in both directions. If we start a sequence like this with some other numbers, some of those sequences will exhibit the same behavior, but those are the ones that can be reduced to either Fibonacci or Lucas numbers by scaling and shifting the sequence. For example, if we start with 3 and 4, we're just getting Lucas numbers from a different point, and if we start with 6 and 8, we'll get all the Lucas numbers times 2. Notable examples in this system that behave differently are the sequence of powers of phi, the golden ratio, and of psi, its negative reciprocal. These belong to the same family of sequences as Fibonacci and Lucas numbers because they have the property of previous two powers adding up to the next one, which stems from the definition of the golden ratio. An integer power of phi will always be greater than 0, and powers of psi, since it's a negative number, will alternate signs for both positive and negative inputs of n. And psi, having absolute value smaller than 1, means it gets bigger under negative powers. Both these power sequences recursively decompose into some multiple of themselves and some multiple of 1. Multiples that are themselves Fibonacci numbers. A property we found in the last video and used to derive a closed form formula for Fibonacci numbers, and then also for Lucas numbers, specifically tied to starting them with 0 and 1 and 2 and 1 respectively. Now, if we get a bit mischievous and plug a non-integer in for n, the closed form formulas give us complex answers, because one of the numbers we're raising to that fractional power, psi, is negative. And this is our starting point today. The continuous complex curves we get are really just a tiny taste of a rich world hiding underneath the definitions we started with. In our journey today, we wouldn't get very far continuing to plot complex numbers against n in three dimensions. It gets disorienting pretty fast. Instead, we'll draw the sequence parametrically, which means we won't be assigning any axis to n, but instead we'll be drawing the complex outputs of the closed form expression directly onto the complex plane. Let's do it for the Fibonacci numbers, starting at 0. They first make their way to 1, and then they have to visit 1 again, so they make this loop through the positive imaginary realm. After that, they continue forward, weaving in and out of real numbers, passing through them exactly at integer indices. If we also extend them back from 0, adding the minus first Fibonacci number, which we've seen is also 1, we'll hit this same spot 3 times. And further into the negatives, we'll be making ever larger loops, visiting negative Fibonacci numbers and coming back to hit the positive ones. What we're interested in our exploration is this characteristic part where we hit 1 3 times and continue forward in this wavy fashion. It kinda looks like a balloon tipped on the side. We'll leave a copy of that shape nearby for reference, and now we draw Lucas numbers in the same way, starting at index 0, where we find the number 2. From there we go back to 1, and then need to reach 3, which gives us this big loop similar to what the Fibonacci curve was doing around index 0. But then it does something we don't see the Fibonacci curve do. On the way to 4, it needs to rapidly change direction, so it makes this kink. Further than that, it just does the usual wavy thing. Extending it backwards 2 elements will give us another loop, and we are getting a shape that looks somewhat related to the Fibonacci curve. It's like the part where the string of the balloon makes that little knot got undone, and now the balloon is open. Okay, maybe that metaphor doesn't work so well, but my point is, it kind of looks like one of these curves could become the other with a little bit of pulling things around. Let's explore. We need to be able to experiment with different starting numbers, which is easy to do if we just want results for integer indices, because we can just keep adding the previous 2 to get the next one. And we can sort of assume the curve will start off something like this, but we can't know for sure since we don't have a closed form formula for sequences started with arbitrary numbers. Let's make one. We'll generalize our quest by saying our sequence starts with numbers A and B. So it will go like this: A plus B, A plus 2B, 2A plus 3B, 3A plus 5B. Doesn't this look familiar? Let's make it more visible by writing out the factors of A and B even when they are 1 or 0. We start with 1 of A and 0 of B, then 0 of A and 1 of B, and the rest follows pretty much the same. Now we can arrange them vertically and focus on the factors, which are pretty obviously Fibonacci numbers. The factors of B start off like the regular Fibonacci sequence, and the factors of A lag one element behind. That lets us generalize the nth element of a sequence that starts with A and B as the nth Fibonacci number of B and n-1st Fibonacci number of A. And since we know the closed form for Fibonacci numbers, we can plug that in and get an expression that we're free to evaluate for any n we like. This won't simplify much, but I will pick one specific way of factoring it that I think best reflects the mechanics of what each number is doing here, and allows to quickly resolve the edge cases we'll be seeing soon. The trick I used here was to apply the fact that phi and psi are negative reciprocals of each other to decompose the n-1 powers. The rest is just distributing and collecting like terms. Good. Empowered with this formula, we can draw a continuous version of any such sequence. And now we can discover how the shapes of the Fibonacci and Lucas curves are related. Starting with the Lucas curve, we'll fix the second starting element, S1, at 1, and begin decreasing the first element. As we hit 1, the kink gets sort of ironed out, and the first 2 ones form a loop, because this is the Fibonacci curve, shifted by one element. Let's expand it on the left, and bring it back to Lucas to see a fuller picture of this transformation. And again. What about up from 2? In this direction, we need to zoom out to see what our starting numbers are doing. Let's stop here, because it just keeps going like this, nothing new will happen. We can see an attempt to form the Fibonacci balloon again that doesn't quite make it, but it does go far enough in this direction to start creating its own loop. These 3 elements that are clustered together will always be off by 1 as the loop grows, so you could imagine that this shape becomes a giant Fibonacci balloon as S0 goes to infinity. Now let's go back to starting with 2 ones, and we'll keep going down from there. Somewhere between 1 and 0, the shape seems to hug the real line ever more closely. In fact, there's a sweet spot where it will completely align with it. Do you recognize this number? It's the positive reciprocal of phi, or phi to minus 1. That means our sequence begins with phi to minus 1, followed by a 1. And we know how those behave. We've stumbled across the power series of 5. This is just a regular old positive number to a real power, an operation that safely stays within the reals, so our curve no longer makes detours through the imaginary realm. Of course, this little gap until 0 will be filled completely by negative powers of I, and considering all real inputs of n, the line will just be all positive real numbers. Let's move on. Just a tiny bit below the reciprocal of I, at 1/2, the Fibonacci shape shows up again. This time, the reason we see it is that it's just 1 and 2 scaled down. Similarly, when we reach 1/3, we get the Lucas shape scaled down. I'll let you figure out why it appears here. Just add a few elements forward and backward and you'll see it. As we go on and reach 0, we just get Fibonacci numbers proper. This extra bit going into the negatives belongs to it. I just skipped 2 elements of this sequence below index 0 around the whole time, so you can see a wider picture of the transformations we were going through. Shifting one of the starting elements backwards makes the range we're observing reach further into the part of these sequences with alternating signs that make these large detours. Let's keep them around, and we'll move on into the negatives. We'll be hitting Lucas and Fibonacci shapes for another round on the way, but then something new happens as we pass minus 1. Exactly at minus phi, all the values on the positive side of the sequence get pulled into the origin, and we get a spiral. The stringy, wavy bit that was always going off to infinity is not there anymore. What is this sequence? Well, minus phi that we have here can also be written as psi to the minus first power, because they are negative reciprocals of each other. And 1, again, can be written as psi to the 0th, because we just get to do that with any base. And if they come one after another like that, we know what happens. We have a power series of psi. Shown like this, they may appear scattered around, but just follow the curve and you'll find they appear in order. This is a shape that resembles a nautilus shell, and it does fit the natural one to some degree, though you might have heard that the nautilus shell is not a golden spiral, and you heard right, it's not. But the shape you're looking at right now is also not a golden spiral, at least not by convention. I won't get into that right now, check the description for a bit of additional information, and let me know in the comments if you'd like to see a deep dive on what's really going on here. There's only one more novel thing left that can happen as we drive S0 further down, and we can see an example of it right away when we get to minus 2. We get the Fibonacci numbers again, with their shape rotated 180 degrees. And of course, we'll eventually get such rotated versions of everything we've seen so far, because on the complex plane, the negative of any number is a half rotation around the origin. All of this might be a lot to take in so quickly, so if you want to play around with it to get a feeling for how it works, there's a link in the description to a Desmos graph that lets you plug in different starting values and see what a sequence looks like in this parametric form. And remember this factoring of the general formula I showed you earlier? Try plugging in the starting elements of some sequences we've explored here to see what makes them tick. Keep in mind that phi and psi are negative reciprocals of each other. It helps a lot to simplify the results you get. Our journey so far took us through all the characteristic forms of sequences we can get by adding one of each of the previous 2 elements, and starting with real numbers. And yes, we could get the full variety by just fixing the second element to 1 and varying the first one. Interesting to think about why that's the case. We had the range of shapes between Lucas and Fibonacci, and the 2 extreme cases generated by powers of phi and psi, all of which also exist in this halfway round rotated version. In general, it's a waving tail and a spiral, created by phi and psi respectively, and if only one of them is involved, then it's only one of those. In part 2, we'll be plugging complex numbers into all the different places in these definitions that we can, and get to see a much wider picture. Hope to see you there. Until then, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed and learned something new. Feel free to ask questions in the comments. I'm still able to keep up with most of them. Here's a link to the playlist of the Golden Ratio series, and you'll also see the link to part 2 of this topic if it's out already. If not, consider subscribing, and you can use the bell to be notified when it comes out. I'm a long way off from being able to spam you with new videos too often, so it's pretty safe. And it helps me. Thank you. Have a lovely day. Bye.